In the 1960s, the East End of London was home to the most feared gangsters in the British criminal underworld.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste.
Three brothers named Krays had ambitions to become the godfathers of British crime. They created an evil empire of violence, extortion, and intimidation.
I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain.
Rumor said they were untouchable. The Krays were only jailed after they had killed at least two people. This is the story of the murder they got away with.
Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name.
Years ago, Dartmoor Prison was the end of the line for the hard men of British crime, the toughest jail in the system. It was from here that the Kray gang arranged the escape of a man they saw as one of their own, an East Ender born and bred. Prisoner number 635 was Frank Samuel Mitchell. He was already a notorious prison escaper when the Krays took him off the moor and sparked the biggest manhunt in British criminal history. Mitchell put his trust in the Krays, but in return, they destroyed him. He disappeared having spent half his life behind bars and just 11 days on the run. Tonight, we solve the mystery of what became of Britain's most wanted man, who found fame and misfortune as a fugitive from the law.
Now these people looking vastly relieved as the van carrying Frank Mitchell comes in. There are a crowd of women and children here and policemen and warders watching him being brought back.
Frank Mitchell first met the Kray brothers on the streets of the East End and later on in prison. The Krays were status-conscious criminal social clients, and they were drawn to Mitchell by his reputation as the most rebellious man in the prison system. Joining the Krays became Mitchell's prison fantasy. But he had no real grasp of the violence and ruthlessness that underpinned the firm. He dreamed of joining the firm and was captivated by a comic book idea of the life of a gangster.
I became known as Reggie's man. I went practically everywhere with Reggie. And whatever business he was in, I would just stand there and growl at people and back him up, sort of thing.
Reggie Kray recruited Albert Donahue to the firm after first shooting him in the leg as a punishment for insulting the twins. But when he didn't grasp, he was put on the payroll and became a core member of the Kray organization.
Prior to that, I worked on doors in the clubs and spoolers and places like that. And then collected. I used to collect on the Friday, the milk round, we called it. Protection money.
In the 1960s, distrust of the police was a proud tradition in the East End. The Krays depended on this, and the fear they instilled to expand their empire of extortion. The Krays had ambitions to become the criminal warlords of the East End, to weave themselves into the fabric of the local community, demanding tribute and dispensing rough justice.
This is the most marvellous meeting place with you. Yes? No?
Local people relied on each other because there was self-help or no help. The Krays had a sentimental attachment to the community spirit which excluded outsiders but also protected villains. They cast themselves as benefactors, collecting money for the local men, the ones in prison, the aways.
The twins would wait until, say, Friday or a Saturday night. The pub was pretty well packed with faces, all his faces. And then Ronnie would say to someone, sometimes me, sometimes somebody else, get the list up for the aways, anyone who's locked up, and go around, do a collection. Leave it till about 10 when they're all nicely ripe, you know, then this money would be sent to somebody who might be short of rent or electric money or money to go on a long distance visit. And that is where this Robin Hood thing came from. Although it wasn't their money, they had been instrumental in getting it together and sending it round.
Were you aware that Frank Mitchell was one of the people that they cultivated in this way?
Well, yeah, and because of their names, and because of his name, obviously they, he's like the two toughest guys on the block, they're going to meet one day. I'm pretty sure Ronnie, always in the back of his mind, is one day we're going to get nicked, and it's best to look after these prison legends.
Well, the first impression of Frank Mitchell is his size. He was about 6'3". He had a 54-inch chest, about a 34-inch waist, and he really was a really big, powerful-looking man. It was not unusual for him to drop on the floor and do endless press-ups just to demonstrate his strength. And he was prone to picking people up as well, at short notice. I think there was a hidden agenda for him. It was like a demonstration that, you know, I really am a powerful man, and although I'm a nice, pleasant guy, there theoretically could be another side to me if things went wrong. And I think that's the message he wanted to get over.
Frank Mitchell was one of seven children born in the 1930s to a poor family in Bow, in the heart of London's East End. His education took second place to scrapping in the streets. He was sent to a special school for children with learning difficulties. Mitchell was easily influenced by the street gangs around him, and soon found himself in trouble with his father, and then the law.
My dad told us that when Frankie was 8, he stole a bike, and instead of letting Frankie keep the bike, he took him to the police station to get a telling off for Frankie's own good, because he didn't want him to steal things. And instead of the police telling him off, they took him to a magistrate's court and they put him on probation. And from there it just went on. Frankie was inside more than he was out. Well, his strength really was a disadvantage to him. That caused a lot of trouble.
It's the prison officers he didn't really like. They made him more, they upset him more, and that's how he got in more trouble, and that's how he got more time added on.
In 1962, aged 33, Mitchell fetched up at Dartmoor after being shunted like a bad penny around almost every institution the system had to offer. He'd been incarcerated for all but a few months since the age of 17. Half his adult life. Mitchell came of age behind bars in a world where violence ensured survival and defying authority earned respect. No prison could handle him for long, but in the Dartmoor regime he found an outlet for his physical prowess.
All in for work.
I knew him pretty well, actually. I spent a lot of time with him. I worked with him on and off for about 6 months on a quarry party, and then I worked with him outside the prison for about 4 months. Prisoners deferred to him because of his reputation as a pecking order, and he was at the top of the pecking order. He was Big Frank, man. He was the man, or one of the very few people in prison who was known probably throughout the whole system. And that was based on his history.
He'd been
in prison on a number of occasions. He'd been birched once for assaulting a member of staff. And he'd been flogged, I think, for cutting an officer's face with a knife.
Flogging means exactly what?
Whipping, put over a bench and actually whipped. Cat of nine tails. He'd suffered that, which was very unusual even in those days.
Frank Mitchell was trapped in a vicious circle of rebellion and punishment, and in the end the prison system washed its hands of him. He was certified mentally defective and sent to Rampton Secure Hospital. He bitterly opposed the move, and it was to have a profound effect on his chances of release. As the police officer who jailed the Krays recalls, he rebelled in the only way he knew.